This recording of the fact-fiction conversation between Clare G. Coleman and Clare Wright at Eltham Library is part of the Yarra Plenty Regional Libraries Book Lovers Festival 2019.
Hi, Clare.
Hi, Clare.
You can distinguish us on paper because Clare has an eye and I don't have an eye. But we do get to have lots of fun hashtags about Clare on Clare and Clare, and a coven of Clares. There's a collective noun for Clares. And we're collecting Clares.
Even Clares that are secretly not Clares.
Oh, that's right. Ginger Clare. There are various Clares who are coming out of the cupboard now. They're coming out as Clares because they want to join the Clare Club.
Ginger Gorman
is actually the only person that we're talking about with. She's actually, in fact, Clare Gorman, but she calls herself Ginger and publishes under that. So you want to go first?
Oh, well, what about? Should we go? We've got some talking points. So we're actually really, really organised, honestly. We're not organised at all.
See, normally when we do literary events like this, we are talking about the books themselves. But we've actually been given a different brief tonight, which is to interview each other about each other as writers and as readers and as Clares. And so we're stepping over each other clearly to start that off. Do you want to go first?
You go. There's a good question here.
Okay.
And I like this one. What are you currently obsessed with? And do your obsessions make it into your work?
Okay. I am currently obsessed with archives, and archives always make it into my work. So this is a bit of a no-brainer, but the reason I'm obsessed with it at the moment is because this week I've just launched a new podcast series that I've been producing all year with my colleague at La Trobe University, Eve Rees, and our podcast is called Archive Fever, and it's a series of interviews with authors and journalists and artists and curators and other academics about the research process and about our obsession with archives. And the term archive fever comes from Jacques Derrida, and he wrote an essay called Archive Fever. I didn't understand a word of Derrida when I studied him as an undergrad at university, except for this concept of archive fever, which is when research bites you in the bum and you just become so addicted to it that, you know, you just think, thank God I'm in the National Library or I'm at the Public Record Office of Victoria, because if I was at Crown Casino right now, I'd be completely screwed. And I can see people nodding away. They know what I mean. It's that feeling of needing to hunt down a lead, to dive deeper into those archives, that feeling of that literally kind of the hairs stand up on the back of your neck when you find something that you didn't know was going to be there or that you were actually searching for. So as an historian, archives are at the absolute basis of what I do professionally, but I suspect that they also lurk deeply in my psyche as well, and that has something to do with my very rootless childhood. But you had a shiftless childhood, Clare. You moved around a lot, and you're interested in archives too, except you make yours up.
I do make them up, it's true. And there's a couple of reasons for that. One of those reasons is that the archives haven't always been kind to Aboriginal people. We are often tortured or punished by the archives. And it's very strange because the archives were used to document our people as people thought were going extinct. So it was a case of what they would now call salvage anthropology, mm-hmm. trying to get as much information as you can before culture goes extinct. Except we're not extinct. So we've got all this stuff which is supposed to be there before we die off, and then we didn't die off. So now, people I know are obsessed with going into the archives and digging up their own lost family histories and using those. Of course, in Terra Nullius, what I did was I got the language of the archives and wrote new ones, which some people can't tell from the real thing.
It's very tricky. It took me about halfway through the book to realise what you were doing, you sneaky person.
Do you know how dangerous that is? If you think about the fact that the archives can be falsified that easily. Mm. I'm not even a historian, and I falsified the language of the archive. Mm. So can you imagine how easily fake news can become a real serious problem? Because if someone writes something convincing as easily as I did it, then we're in trouble.
We are, agree. Actually, one of the people that we interview in Archive Fever is Tony Birch, and an Indigenous writer, poet, historian. Tony and I actually started uni together at the same time. He's 10 years older than me. He's 60 and I just turned 50, but because he had a whole nother life before he went to uni, we started uni at the same time, so we've known each other for years. And he talks about decolonising the archive. Yes. What does that mean to you?
Well, the archive is inherently colonial. And if you think about the people say archives are neutral, those people either don't know anything about how history is recorded or they're lying. Because when the archive was recorded, it's recorded with bias. Humans choose what in the archive is important. That's the first thing that makes archive bias. Someone has chosen what to put in the archive and what not to put in the archive. And then the way things are recorded is biased as well. And I did a keynote at the Archivist Conference last year. And the topic of my keynote was attacking archivists who consider themselves to be neutral and saying archives are not neutral because no human in anything they do is unbiased. So the archivists are never neutral. They have to be very careful to ensure that in their decision making that they're making the right decisions on what to record and how to record it. So decolonizing the archive is basically about accepting that the archive is not neutral and restoring the balance between colonial information and pre-colonial information and removing the racial bias from the archive, I'm sure you're perfectly aware of the bias, the racial bias in history.
Well, I'm aware of the racial bias, but the bias that has affected me in my writing more is the gender bias. So my relationship to the archive and my whole way of doing history and practicing history is exactly with that idea that the archive is not neutral, but it's stable to the extent that it is built up layer upon layer, and it is sediments of archive. And then your role in it as an historian is almost as an archaeologist to go in there and peel back those layers. But the way that you do that is not with a trowel and something, I don't know the names of tools, chip something that's going to chip things away. Your questions chip things away. As an historian, what you're asking of the archive is the crucial factor. So, for example, with the Forgotten Rebels of Eureka, when I started talking about writing a book about Eureka a long time ago now with my academic peers, all these old dudes would say, well, what could you possibly write about Eureka that hasn't already been said? It's been written about it happened 150 years ago. It's been written about at least the last 100 years. And what could you say that's new? And that was like a red rag to a bull to me, so good on them. And because I was interested to know what women's role might have been, because the way that I was taught about Eureka when I was at primary school, and no doubt when you were at primary school, and when my kids were at primary school, and when my kids were at high school, is exactly the same as it's been taught, which was that it was male miners and male military out in Ballarat on the frontier gunning it out for the rights and freedoms that today we hold to be the quintessential to who we are as Australians, and that Ballarat is the birthplace of democracy. But somehow women weren't part of that birth. And so I went back to test the archive, basically, with working on the principle that the past is a time concept But history is a human construct. And what I found was that I went back to the same archives that all those other dudes had written their books from, but going with a different set of questions meant I found completely different answers. I found all the women who were there because a third of the Ballarat population were women and children. And because the Eureka Stockade was a community grassroots mass protest movement, women have always been at the forefront of those, as they still are. Women were engaged in every aspect of that protest. And the same with Your Daughters of Freedom, which is set in the Federation era. Now, Federation has always been written about as if they were only founding fathers. And yet, when you go back with a different lens, with a different set of questions, there are all the women nation building. The white women.
Yes.
So, well, which we can talk about. So my lens on the archive has been from particularly from that female perspective, and it's those disruptive questions that are what ultimately destabilize the archive itself. And so in some ways I would say the archive is neutral. In that it holds the answers, but it's the questions that you ask. But I do take your point that it's not neutral because it's who's created those documents in the first place. So if you're looking for women, you'll find them. You'll find them in a different way than you'll find men. If you're looking for Indigenous people, you'll find them too, but you'll find them in the way that they were framed by the white colonisers.
And that reminds me of, there's a couple of things. You said that you have to mine through the sediments of the archive. What I try and do with my fiction writing is crack the sediments of memory of history, because people have accretions of what
you put
they
a
think.
Stick of dynamite under it, Claire.
Yes, I do. That's true. Well, that's the plan anyway. The plan is to find the crack in what people have learned and blow it up, and so they can look at things in a different way. Someone did something similar with the archive, which is Bruce Pascoe went back into the archive and looked at looked for the evidence that Aboriginal people were simple hunter-gatherers, and found out the exact opposite, that we were in fact, we had farming and
agriculturists,
agriculturists and aquaculturists, and have the oldest aquacultural sites on earth. So if you think about the fact is that history isn't neutral either. Historians aren't neutral. Archivists aren't neutral. In fact, nobody's neutral. I'm not neutral. I've got an agenda, I admit it. And I think the people who end up with all